Hello, multi Mumbai cars. And thank you to Aswand Arol for the malt mention. Thank you, Aswand. I do suspect, actually, that I've slightly mispronounced. Instead, I said Mumbai. It meant I should have said Mumbai, rightio. Which, of course, is a Mumbai car, someone from Mumbai in India. Rightio. And I've tasted whiskies from India, including Paul John, quite nice, and Amrut, enjoyed that one as well. And we're going to be seeing more from India before too long, but not this one. This in Ralfy Review 701 is the oldest blended Scotch whisky I've ever reviewed. It's called Antiquary, 35 year old. Blended Scotch, bottled at 46%, and unchill-filtered, and natural colour. Now, before I go any further, those observant forensic malt mates of you will distinctly remember in Ralfy Review 700, I said 36-year-old blend. Oopsie, it was a blooper. These things happen, shrug of the shoulders and move on. This has been sitting in the glass for the last half hour. I poured one earlier, half an hour ago. Quite important that, and you know why. I don't even have to tell you these days because you fully understand why, but I'm going to pour a second glass. This is the new pour. So, as you can see, identical whiskies. Obviously, I'm pouring a lot less in the second glass because, frankly, this is expensive and precious stuff, malt mates, and I've got to make it last. Even my budget, this self-financing hobby of mine, has its restraints, and there's no way I would be buying single malt at 35 years. Those days have long since gone. But to taste some really old whiskey, the one opportunity that is left at an accessible price, if you've got a good budget or if you're prepared to pool the cost with a whiskey club or friends, is your blended aged whiskies. The big question is, sure, whiskey improves with age, but for how long? And as time goes on in the cask, are the improvements considerable over time or just fractional and nominal over time? Good question. And the answer is quite simple. It varies significantly between whiskies, and you may come across some really old single malts which have a grand age statement, and I've tasted them 40, 50 year old single malts, which are frankly exhausted. Sure, they're providing a great experience, but that spirit-driven content, it isn't really there anymore. It's all about the cask, because the cask has spent so, so long influencing the spirit. And bear in mind, malt mates, Scotch whisky is made from malted barley, and malted barley spirit is a delicate spirit. It isn't robust like corn spirit or sugarcane spirit. It doesn't have that density and weight of character. I've completely lost my train of thought. Sorry for swearing, malt mates. Oh dear. Now I'm in a dilemma now. Do I press stop and delete, or do I carry on? I'm just going to carry on. Stuff it. You know, it's all part. This is live, unedited. You know, there's so much editing going on online with so many vlogs. What's happened is I've been talking about something and I've completely forgotten what I'm talking about. But I'm going to just focus now on smelling and tasting this, telling you all about it, and then adding some extra information. Adding water to a really old blend. I'll do this slowly. drip. One little drip. Be so, so careful, malt mates. So careful. When you're adding water, if you do it at all, to old, old whiskies, it doesn't matter, malt or blend, they can drown so easily. And if they drown, if they lose their vitality in dilution, you will not recover it unless you pour a clean, fresh glass. You can't just add whiskey to it and expect it to kind of pull back again. It doesn't work that way. It's a one-way trip. So we stroly-poly around the glass, no shaky-shakies. All Antiquary bottlings are good. I've reviewed the 12-year-old. It's a great blend, by the way, a traditional blend. And what I'm nosing here is a real traditional. It's got that big, rich fruitcake and age. You can smell 35 years. And this is the benefit of a blend, an old blend. They know they've got a discerning market. Therefore, they keep the involvement of grain content from column stills to a minimum. And in this instance, you hardly even notice it. It is so integrated with the malt. The malt has got this lovely, big, traditional cask element to it, where it's not just a lucky cask. The blender, who doesn't spend a lot of time, I mean, this is the luxury end of the blender's job. This is the happy end of the job, where they're not just putting out standard blends on a regular basis. These are small batch whiskies. So the blender gets to kind of go into the warehouse and really pick out the best of the best to kind of showcase the reputation of the brand. It isn't huge in the nose. It's subtle but bold. Fruitcake, vintage fruitcake, definitely. A tiny hint of peat in the background and some beautifully reserved and restrained traditional sherry cask, which probably matured sherry in its lifetime. Bear in mind at 35 years, it's 2017, so we're way back in the... Where are we? I'm having to do mental arithmetic now. It's the winter blues, malt mates. Bear with me. Okay, right, we'll go to 2015 to 80. It's the 1980s. Some lovely, soft, citrus complex, loads of spice and nutmeg and cardamom and soft cinnamon. There is so much going on. Quite literally, you could spend hours with your nose in this glass and still be finding stuff in there. Taste. The fact that it's bottled at 46% gives them that extra strength to deliver the fullness of the arrival. The arrival is soft, gentle, almost fructose sweetness. And everything's there. Sweet, sour, bitter, salt and savoury. All the sensations are in here. And there is a dazzling array of actual flavours from raisin, muscovado, mild, gentle, fresh licorice, some softest clove, some gentlest of fresh ginger notes. I'm not going to go on and on and on, but I could go on and on and on about all the constituents, all the little flavour constituents that I'm finding in this glass. This is one of these whiskies where you pour a glass and it lasts you the rest of the night. And the bliss point, the perfect pitch, just will slowly arrive in its own accord if you get the water right. As I said, with these old, old, old whiskies, less water the better. Even if you want to have it neat, fair enough. But you will find that even a drop of water just starts to kick off the activity of flavour release, both smell and taste. In all probability, ooh, You know, I'm tasting history here. I'm tasting whiskies that I remember back 20 years ago. Whiskies that I've tasted in warehouses, in distilleries, in various locations in Scotland, which I never thought I'd taste again, but this has been an opportunity. And it's the winter time, and it's a time to really treat yourself, whether you can afford it on your own or group together with friends, buy one bottle and share it out. It's giving you a fuller experience of what whiskey can be, of what spirits can actually be. If I go to the glass I've just poured, and if I nose this, far less is happening, far, far less. You saw me pour it. It's closed up, it's closed down, it's uptight, and it just simply hasn't had time to start to show itself. When you see someone pour an old whiskey into a glass and have, if they finished it within 15 minutes, you can tell them on behalf of me, tell them Ralphie said that they are wasting their time and wasting precious liquor. Simples. When you taste the fresh poured, new poured, old blend, 10 minutes in the glass, that's all. You get something sharp, confectionery, lozenge, mint, wintergreen, menthol. Basically, you're getting a whiskey which hasn't even begun to awake from its slumber in the cask and its rest in the bottle. It just hasn't. This I'll put aside for later. Back to the whiskey which has been allowed to, it's just been given time to do what it needs to do. I'm going to give this a blend mark now. The form is fabulous. The length of the arrival. So substantial in the arrival. So complex. Now into the development. Development is intense and delicate. Hugely complex. Robust, soft. So you've got these contradictions going on, but very beautifully composed. Wonderful composure. Probably about 80% malt, 20% grain. But bear in mind, the grain itself is a minimum 35 years old. So that the grain content from column stills, along with the malt, they have both independently been maturing for over 35 years. 93 out of 100, and that, my merry maltsters, is a blend mark. So why have I gone to the extravagance of buying an old blend to review for you? Because they're expensive. They're very expensive. They make a hole in your budget. And the reason I bought this was to treat myself at the end of the year as winter is really kicking in on the Irish Sea. And this bottle I will share with my very best of friends. And this bottle will be treasured and will probably be seeing in the new year, be seeing in 2018. And one reason I bought this bottle is because it is a reputable brand which cannot afford to put out a tired, diminished, geriatric old malt and sell it specifically on the age statement. Isn't it funny how you never get non-age statement whiskies when they're really old? Because it's the age statement, high-end age statements, which really help to elevate the price because they're simply rarer. There's less of them. And in many instances, they can carry something extra in the experience that you're not going to get in young whiskies, and it's perfectly true. But the beauty of this is it's not just about the subjective leather armchair, old polish, bookcases and dusty books. There's a freshness to it as well, which only comes from someone blending this together who really knows what they're doing and has the material to do so. And you can imagine that for distilleries, they may have a slightly underperforming old whiskey, but the age statement's genuine, the cask has been good. Obviously, they've got to look after business, and yes, they're going to bottle it. And I would too in their position. But there's something I'd like to conclude with this vlog. Excuse me a second. My willpower has just totally collapsed. The pace is so slow. Development. Still going on. Still developing. Oh, some lovely little savoury, slightly charcoal and mint notes. Charcoal, mint and granite. Some little touch of metal in there. But it just is part and parcel of these subjective interactions that just come with time, and it's beautiful. Not that I spend much time eating or tasting metal, you understand, but that's what I'm sensing here. Right. Prompt board. This is Antiquary. This is the price. 35 years old. In the UK, roughly £261 a bottle. I'll let you translate that into your own currency. Yes, it's expensive. For anyone on a budget, you maybe go to a whiskey event and hopefully you get to taste it. But if you're on a tight budget, there's an awful lot younger, decent whiskies that you can buy without going to this. Interestingly, this works out at £7.46 per year of maturation. So that's £261 divided by 35. If I had, at the same retailer, bought an independent bottling, not even an official bottling, but an independent bottling of a Delphi 35-year-old Springbank, that bottle would have cost me £2,500, simply because it's a malt and simply because it's Springbank, and Springbank has got a big reputation. That works out at £71.43 per year of maturation. Finally, we come to an official bottling, a single malt which ages well. I've tasted them. They can be magnificent. Delmore. 35-year-old Delmore. Beautifully presented. No more cardboard packaging. We're onto the wooden boxes now. Although I have to say this is very substantial cardboard packaging. It's lovely packaging without being over the top. But here we are at £3,650 a bottle. How much does that work out per year of maturation? It works out at £104.29 per year of maturation. That's what you're actually paying. So you can see immediately that if you are financially restrained, but you want to treat yourself, particularly if you've got a group of friends, if there's 6 or 12 of you even, you can chip in, and rather than look at really old single malts, do not overlook old blends. Of course you're going to check them out. You need to check them out. You cannot be affording to be making mistakes at these prices. You just can't. But I knew damn well when I bought this, There was no mistakes going to be made. 93 out of 100. You know, I put it in 93 and a half, not quite 94, which would be the second highest mark I've ever awarded in a whisky in 8 years. And that's a lot of whisky I've been giving malt marks to and blend marks. But I would even elevate this and say that, sure, it's a blend, but I could also call it a malt mark at this calibre. So there you are, you've got a point of reference here. And the way the price of whiskey is going and the international demand is bottles like these, which tend to kind of be a little bit off the radar, which can provide some of the best value, really old whiskey experiences. And when you have experienced this at least once in your life, malt mates, you have this additional, highly memorable point of reference of something truly magnificent, where you can compare it to your standard bottlings, and you may find from your personal experience, and it is personal, that you're very happy with the quality of your standard single malts or good quality blends, because you now have a very tangible and direct comparison to something this old and this antiquated, an antiquated antiquary. I'll just say that once. I don't want any more bloopers in this whiskey, this Ralfy review. There's just, I've tasted a lot of whiskies over the years. A lot. And it's not that many really that kind of stop me in my tracks, but this does. It's just lovely, lovely stuff. I'm Ralfy. I'm finished now. If you pop back for Ralfy Review 702, I will be reviewing a much younger, readily available Lowland single malt, which is nothing like this, but it has its own qualities, and importantly, it's much more affordable. Thank you for watching.